Welcome to episode number 43 of the Mastering Marriage Podcast, where our goal is to strengthen, unite, and restore your marriage. Hey, everybody. My name is Amanda Taylor. And together with my husband, David, we are the co-founders of MendOurMarriage.com. And our goal is to break the back of divorce by bringing married couples together to be accountable, keep the passion alive, and expose the hidden issues that try to rip marriages apart. And we are happy to be back in the booth today with me, of course, Amanda Taylor, and with my co-host, my honey, David Taylor.
Hey, guys. Welcome back.
What's up, everybody?
Another action-packed, information-packed episode of the Mastering Marriage Podcast.
Yes.
And today we have a lot of juicy nuggets to drop. Like, I know we say that every show, but we really got a lot of information to share with you today.
May have to do a part two.
Well, hopefully not, because I want to get this all out. But before we get started, I just would like to say thank you again for tuning in. This show is sponsored and brought to you on behalf of Motivated to Love. The Amazon best-selling Motivated to Love.
Thanks, everybody, for making that happen.
And this book is something that has changed our lives. It's opened up many doors to many opportunities. And it's not only just about us, but it's changing thousands of marriages. Yes. Not just hundreds, but thousands of marriages.
Wow.
And so this
You're
is
so
a
thankful.
This is a book and a tool that if you haven't gotten your hands on yet, please go to Motivated, the number 2, love.com. That's Motivated, the number 2, love.com, to pick up your copy. Or you can go to Amazon, because it's on Amazon now. Mm-hmm. And it's a bestseller there. I know I said that. I just like saying that because Mandy gets so shy. But go there, check it out. Motivated to Love. Let us know what you think. Join the private Facebook group because we are having a blast there and we got some new things rolling out for the people that's there.
Right, for those who buy the book.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So feel free to go ahead and join that as well. In any case, speaking of the group, this podcast is going to be over a topic that I discussed, maybe two weeks ago
mm-hmm.
in Mandy's private Facebook group. So if you aren't in that group, then this is going to be brand new to you. If you are in that group, for those who are on the call, take delight in this again.
Yes.
But we're going to be talking about a very touchy and important topic today. It's about standing for your spouse without getting lost. Mm-hmm. And if you haven't noticed by now, Mend Our Marriage, the very essence of Mend Our Marriage, is focused not just on like all marriages, mm-hmm. but it's focused on hurting marriages.
Right.
Hence the term Mend Our Marriage.
Yes.
And so there's a lot of other organizations and businesses out there that focus just on marriages in general, but we want to help those who are hurting,
right.
those who are on the brink of divorce like we were.
Right.
And so this particular topic, standing for your spouse without getting lost, mm-hmm. is directly for you spouses who are considered standers.
Mm-hmm.
Those that are in a relationship, your spouse is reluctant, like I used to be, they're not necessarily in the marriage, and you feel at times that you're getting swept away by the emotions, by the stress and the weight of being a motivated spouse.
Right. And the inconsistency of the behaviors of your spouse can definitely be discouraging.
Yeah. And so this episode number 43, is going to bless every bit of a sock that you have on your feet off. It's going to bless them off. So let's go ahead and get started because we got a lot of information. You ready for this, baby?
Let's go.
You sure?
Yeah,
and then in the end, we'll kind of talk to you about what's going on next, actually in a couple of days, you know, because we're excited for that as well. But anyway,
yes.
So let's start. All right. So I'll just start by saying this. Excuse me. Standing for your reluctant spouse is an exhausting, lonely, and sometimes depressing, scary process.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And we have a lot of empathy for those. And actually, there's a couple of spouses that we're working with. Specifically that comes to mind who are like doing the impossible.
Mm.
And it's very, very impressive. And I mean, it's noble. And
right.
so we really get a lot of strength from them, but it can be exhausting. Standing for your spouse is a very like troubling, like lonely process.
Mm.
You know, most standers, they start the process with high hopes, right? But then they burn out and that what could be like 2 weeks, 1 week, then they burn out quickly.
Yeah.
You know?
It could be a couple months. Just depends on the person.
Just depends on the person and what's going on in their lives. But it's very common for standers to get so consumed with the standing process that they lose focus of everything else. Like, you're standing on the bank of a river and, you know, that represents your stand. You're standing on the bank of a chaotic river. And the next thing you know, you're somehow been swept downstream without you even being aware of it. And that's what it's like. That's what we work with spouses and they say it all the time, you know, and it's like a cycle. You know, they get motivated at first and then all of a sudden they get like lost in those emotions and lost in the process. And so it's good to have somebody there that can help bring them back and anchor them. Mm-hmm. But I want to talk to you guys today about a few things that you can do to make sure that you don't lose yourself while standing for your lost spouse. So if you're driving, if you're at the gym, if you're on the train, whatever the case may be, take notes. Okay. You may have to go back and rewind this, but trust me, take some notes, because I want you guys to really like digest this information. Okay. This isn't just good head stuff. This is heart stuff. So, all right. So here we go. Let me start with sharing with you some tips that you can do to help you not get lost while standing. And then Mandy, you just do your magic. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. So, all right. Here's the first thing. Remember that the stand that you're doing, this stand, is not just about getting your spouse back. Okay. I know most of you are like, well, ain't that the purpose is to get my marriage restored. I understand. But you have to have this in your mind that you standing for your spouse mm-hmm. is not about getting your spouse back. Mm-hmm. Although this is a huge motivation, right? It's definitely motivating to stand for your spouse, but that cannot be the primary purpose of your mm-hmm. stand. Mm-hmm. It has to be more about becoming the best version of yourself. Okay? Imagine, like, if after all the warring that Mandy did and the interceding and crying out to God that she did for me, imagine if I ended up getting hit by a car and dying the next day. I know that sounds kind of, you know, that's not funny, Mandy. If I got hit, you shouldn't laugh.
I'm not laughing.
That's not funny. But anyway, imagine if that happened. After all the effort Mandy put in, I finally come back to the marriage and then I get hit by a car the next day and die. Well, Mandy's life still has to go on. And the same has to be for you, okay? Your job is to become the best version of yourself. Mm-hmm. Not just to get focused on praying and focused on God just for the sake of bringing your spouse back. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, most reluctant spouses will notice this. Mm-hmm. And that's a severe turnoff. So if right. you're praying just to save your marriage, they're going to recognize it and they're going to feel extremely spiritually manipulated.
Right. Your motives have to be pure. And when you accept God's call to stand for your marriage, you have to understand, just piggybacking off what David said, like he said, it's about you becoming the best version of yourself. Mm-hmm. And that means getting to know God and developing a tangible relationship with him.
Yes.
So that you can know who you are. Because yes. who oh. else to go to but your creator to find out who you are.
Exactly. Exactly. Let's go to the next point. Remember that this stand is a strategic stand. Okay. It doesn't have just a beginning and an ending. There will be stages to reconciliation that you go through, right? So just remember that there are stages to reconciliation. It's just not a beginning and an end, right? There's going to be cycles. Some that will feel like you are victorious, like there'll be days and weeks that you may feel like you're on top of the world. And then there'll be moments when you feel like you're losing the battle.
Right.
Don't fear that. Understand that that's part of the normal cycle of reconciliation. Moments when you're extremely high, and moments when you're extremely low, okay? Mm-hmm. Expect the ups and downs to come. Mm-hmm. Expect them to come. That way you're not turned off or scared when the downs come, but expect them to come. Don't reject the dark moments, mm-hmm. okay? Actually, what we say is lean into those moments. Lean into the down moments, the dark moments, so that you can get the key that is hidden in that phase. I believe there are keys for the next level that's hidden in your current level, and if you miss it, then you'll be ill-equipped when you go to the next level.
Right.
So lean into those dark moments. Don't stray away from them. You will actually learn more about yourself in the dark moments than you will when the process is easy and productive.
Right.
Okay? So don't shy away from that. Ready to go on to the next one?
Let's go.
All right. The third one is this. And this is a good one, guys. Strengthen your circle. Keep negative people out. Period. Keep them suckers out. Don't let them in. Mm-hmm. Protect your mind from people who intend to do good but are misinformed, right? Watch what you watch and watch what you listen to. Mm-hmm. Protect your mind, protect your eye gate, protect your ears. Okay. Mm-hmm. If you intentionally allow negative things into your mind, they will begin to take root and it's going to affect how you perceive certain things during the stand. So strengthen your circle. Keep people out that ain't going to help you.
Now understand that even people who may be in your family or mentors or people who are close to you, they may not be able to stand with you in this season, even though they mean well.
Yeah.
Sometimes they may not have that same word from God that you have.
Exactly.
And you have to step away from them for a little while.
And some may call you crazy, and that's okay.
Yeah.
That's okay. It takes crazy love to love. It does. I mean, love is not one of those things that most people accept nowadays.
And most people, a lot of people that say that do not have spiritual discernment either.
Yeah.
And so they're not open to the concept of unconditional love like Jesus showed us.
Exactly.
So you can't expect them to understand that if they don't have that same relationship and knowledge.
I agree. So let's move on to the fourth. The danger is to follow your instincts, which are usually fueled by what you see. So don't follow your instincts, right? The battle for your marriage is spiritual. It is actually more spiritual than natural. Mm-hmm. Consider the fact that through marriage, we're able to do the one thing that Satan can't do. Think about that. Like, we're able to literally create something out of nothing through union, through becoming one with another person. The one thing that makes us more like God than he could ever be. And he hates that. His job is truly to kill, steal, and destroy.
That's right.
So remember, like if your husband or your spouse, your wife, is merely, if they're reluctant, they're merely a temporary casualty of spiritual tension, right? So they're merely a temporary casualty. The battle is not lost. Just because they may be reluctant or they want a divorce or they say they don't love you, that's merely a temporary casualty of spiritual tensions. And actually, these spiritual tensions have literally been going on for thousands of years, right? This is the war that Satan waged against God, even though it's a losing battle for him. And his job is to strip away the one thing that, right, looks like God, which is us, and marriage. And so you got to remember, your husband or your wife, they're not the enemy. They're not the enemy.
Yes.
You can't treat them like the enemy.
Yes, and we have to learn how to cry for them instead of crying because of them.
Yes.
Again, crying for them instead of crying because of them. And that comes with trusting God and believing God and getting stronger in your faith.
Yeah.
And we have to understand that, just going back to like point number one, we said that it's more than about your marriage. So your stand is about you interceding for the soul of your spouse and for their salvation.
Yeah.
That should be number one before you try to get the marriage back.
Yeah.
You want them to be reconciled to God. That way God is the foundation and will hold your marriage together.
That's key. And that's deep. And that's huge. Go on, preach, baby. Let me dab that forehead. Let me dab it. Let's go to the next one. All right. So the next one is this. Resist the urge to create expectations for your spouse. Mm-hmm. This is huge. I promise you, most issues in marriage come out of unmet expectations.
Right.
Resist the urge to create expectations for your spouse. And again, we're talking about how to stand for your spouse without getting lost. Okay? Resist the urge to create expectations for your spouse. I know that hearing this can be difficult for some of you, but trust me, you will be far better off on the long run of your relationship if you remain wise about how you protect your emotions. Trust me. Don't all of a sudden create expectations because things are going smoothly. And we've seen this a lot. Like, they'll be standing for their spouse. All of a sudden, things are working out great. You know, he came back home. They're having sex again. He said he wants the marriage to last. Or she says that, you know, she's back. She's cut off the extracurricular relationship. And all of a sudden, you begin to create expectations because things are going smoothly. We say it this way. Until he or she completely recommits together and the both of you are able to create expectations together, you should limit the amount of emotional influence that your spouse has in your life. I'll say that again. Until they actually commit completely and until you guys actually sit down together to map out what the expectations for the relationship should look like, until that happens, you should limit the amount of emotional influence that your spouse has in your life. That means that you're not opening your heart such that they could come in and do more damage.
And tear you down.
And tear you down.
Yeah.
Because a reluctant spouse will push and pull. That's their cycle. There's going to be times when they pull you close and be time when they push you far. You got to realize that. And if you buy into the pull, then when they push you, you're going to be devastated.
You have to think about it even. Use the example of how even in our relationship with God, we push and pull a lot.
Mm-hmm.
We, you know, we draw near to him when we need him and we feel close. And sometimes we push away when we feel guilty or shame because maybe we're not doing what we think we should be doing.
Yeah.
But God is still patient with us and he still loves us unconditionally.
Yeah.
And he's still consistent in our lives.
And speaking of emotional influence, expect for your emotions to fluctuate as well. Remember how we talked about in the previous point, there's going to be ups and downs to the process. Expect for your emotions to have ups and downs, right? Meaning, don't just go with what you feel, okay? Don't just go with what you feel. Question every emotion that you have. And I know you're like, Dave, that sounds like a lot of work. And yes, it's going to be a lot of work, but you need to have this a lot of work to take place in order for you to become the best version of yourself,
right,
which is step number one. Mm-hmm. But question everything, like seriously, question the emotions that you experience so that you can be as self-aware as possible. Okay? So when you have an emotion, before you allow your emotion to influence how you react, question it first. Okay? And you should just be doing this anyway. This is just part of the normal human process, is making sure that you're not led by your emotion. The Bible talks about that.
Right.
All right, let's go to the next one. So, well, let me say it this way before I go to the next one. The more self-aware you are, the better you will be at managing your emotions. Mm-hmm. And that's why we talk about this, because we always say be balanced, be emotionally balanced. If you're going to stand for your spouse, you have to be emotionally balanced. If you're up one day and down the next, this stand is going to be long and arduous, and you probably won't have a lot of success.
And another way you become self-aware is by, again, seeking God and saying, God, show me my heart. Show me my motives. You know, you may have to do that every day, you know, for a while, and allow God to speak to your heart. And he may not speak audibly, but he may allow a situation to come up where certain emotions rise up in you and you're able to see, I still have buttons there.
Mm-hmm.
I still have issues there. Lord, help me, heal me from these things.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Let's go to the next point. The next point is this. Remember that your spouse, they're acting out of their feelings just like you are, right? If you're being honest. I mean, now, they're acting out of their feelings and is manifesting a different way than yours is. Mm-hmm. But they're acting out of their feelings and their emotions just like you are. They've just chosen a different approach to expressing their feelings than you have. But both of you may be trying to express the same feeling, right? It may be fear that both of you guys are trying to express, or hurt, or disappointment, or anxiety. But you're just choosing to express it a different manner than your spouse. So don't get mad at them for reacting in a negative way if they're trying to express the same emotions that you're trying to express and yours just look different than theirs, if that makes sense.
Give an example.
Well, I just did with, like, fear. Like, if both of you guys are trying to... Oh, okay, I see what you're saying. If you guys are trying to... Let's say both of you guys are struggling with the frustration, financial frustration, but he shuts down because he's frustrated and overwhelmed with the finances and the pressure's so heavy, but he shuts down. And instead of shutting down, you are more instigator. You are more talkative. You're the one that goes and asks more questions. Both of you guys are trying to express the same emotions. You just do it differently.
Right.
So that's an example.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you for asking and forcing me to be clear. I need to be clear.
Yes.
Appreciate that.
Okay. Well, I'm here for.
Teammate. Teamwork. What's the teamwork makes the dream
work?
Okay.
It helps people to understand.
Okay, so let's go to the next one. Here's the next one. Remember that your spouse, well, this is actually for the wives. So dudes, just take a break. But women, remember that your husband will most likely not have an idea of how to be a man and a husband. Most likely. Not all, okay? And I say this because most men don't grow up receiving the appropriate script of masculinity. So as little boys, they didn't get a script of how to be men. They didn't get a script of how to be husbands. I know I didn't. And I'm not saying everybody's like me, but most men that I know have gone through the same thing. They grew up in a fatherless household or with a father who was absentee, and they did not get a script on proper, like, masculinity or proper or how to position yourself as a healthy husband. And so just remember that they don't have that information. So again, you can't give what you don't have. Don't expect them to give you what they don't have.
Right?
Just like you wouldn't expect a baby to pick up and walk on day one, understand that if your husband has a low emotional intelligence, they will make more mistakes than successes as they try to figure out what is going on in their world. Just remember that, okay? Hold them to the level of where they are. Mm-hmm. I know you have high expectations, but baby girl, you got to let them go for a second. As they heal, just understand that they may not be able to give you what they don't have.
Right, and that's why it's important, again, you're seeking God to know the heart and the struggle of your spouse.
Yeah.
Because then he can show you where they are, what they're struggling with from their past and even from their present.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can pray on their behalf. Again, you're crying out for them instead of groaning and moaning because of them.
Yeah.
And it takes discipline and practice and an extended level of faith.
And let me add this part. For most reluctant spouses, especially for those of you with spouses who are still in the home, this is key, guys. They will need a safe and secure environment in order for them to even think about becoming emotionally vulnerable. So just remember, they will need a safe and secure environment in order for them to even think about becoming emotionally vulnerable. And safety and security for you will most likely look completely different than what safety and security looks like for them. Mm-hmm. So don't sit there and say, well, I have a safe and secure environment in my home. Because you may feel that way, right? Your kids may feel that way. But does he? And his definition may be completely different, okay? And there are steps to figuring out what that looks like, but we can't give that to you right now because we got more to give you. All right, so here's another key. Stay anchored, period. Consistency and emotional balance are paramount to your success during this season of your marriage. So stay anchored. None of this up and then down and then up and down and I quit. I'm tired. I give up. If you say you're going to stand for your marriage, you have to stand. And having done all to stand, what does the Bible say do?
Stand.
Okay. So the Bible even talks about being anchored and having done all to stand. When you ran out of all your options, your butt still needs to stand.
And then remember, and David did say earlier that there will be moments where you have dark moments and you do feel weak. So it's not about not having those moments, but it's about not being, it's about not being pushed and pulled, I guess, by those emotions.
Yeah.
You know, going back to what David said about not allowing your spouse to have that emotional influence. God should have the most influence over your emotions and just over your, just who you are.
Yeah.
He should have that more than your spouse or anybody else does.
Yeah. And emotions are neutral. So they're not an unhealthy or not an unnatural thing. They're neutral. You just have to know how to control them. But let me give you another point about staying anchored. Don't get lazy or emotionally blind just because you've had a few good days with your spouse. This tends to happen. I promise you. We see this almost with every couple that we've worked with. They get emotionally blind when things are going good, which is normal. But we're telling you don't do it, so you know it's coming. There's going to come a time when you're tempted to let your guard down because things are looking nice. Relapse, remember this, relapse is a normal part of the reluctant spouse process, right? Relapse is normal for reluctant spouses. Expect it. Expect them to relapse. I'm not saying be pessimistic. I'm just saying expect them to relapse. Plan for it. That way, you can hope for the best, even though you're planning for the worst.
Right. Okay? And understand that God is still working in their heart and still probably he could be working some things out in you, too.
Yeah.
Still. So even though you want them back in the house right now, I want them to want to come back right now. It may not be good timing unless you want things to go back the way they were.
Yeah. Just, you know, hope for the best, plan for the worst. It's just like if you're going on to a theme park and they say it's going to rain. You're going to take your tail to umbrella, aren't you? You're going to make sure you plan for it to rain, even though you're hoping that it doesn't. Do the same thing when it comes to standing for your spouse. Don't get bent out of shape because they come back and all of a sudden you see them texting her again or you see them texting him again. Remember, relapse is a normal part of the process. It's just like any person with an addictive habit, they're going to have a relapse. It happens. Relapse in sin.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I was on my preacher.
No, that's okay.
I had a preacher moment.
That's good. That's all right.
Yeah.
But no, what I was going to say was, and when they do draw close to you or I guess pull you close, And let's say they go back the other way. That will reveal the motives of your heart in that moment.
That's good.
Because if they do relapse and you say, forget it, I'm giving
then
up.
You was faking.
Then you was faking.
And or I know that's you weren't hard. Standing strong.
Or you weren't standing. Yeah, you weren't standing on a firm foundation.
You weren't anchored.
That's the right. You weren't anchored. Yeah. But if they waver and you are still able to stand strong on, you know, on love, you know, you've been studying love, you've been, you know, staying in God's face, then it's not going to change who you are and what you've been called to do.
That's good.
And it may take a time or two for that to happen.
Yeah.
You know, and you that may come, you may face that and, you know, it may slap you in the face, you know, and you might be like, okay, you know what? I really think I was just standing and doing all this changing just for the marriage. And it wasn't real.
Look, we all been through it. Mandy did it.
Yeah, I mean, we
all been through it, you know? So, it's normal. Relapse is normal. And just like they will have relapse, you may have relapse.
Right.
Expect it. Like we said in a couple points earlier.
But it's about what you do once you relapse. What do you do next?
Be honest about it. Lean into it. Learn from it and move on. That's what I just answered it
for you.
There you go. All right, let's go to the next one. Okay. Here's the next one. Sometimes it's okay for you to take an emotional and mental rest day. It's okay to take a day off. Okay? Or a week off. That's kind of long, but it's okay to take some time off to rest emotionally and mentally. Right? Go watch a good comedy show. Spend some time in the sun, like literally. Go to the beach. Go to the gym. Eat you some chocolate, covered ice cream, or whatever the case may be. A little sip of wine if that's your thing.
But I would say at least one day a week.
It's okay to take some time off.
Yeah, you have to do that.
Yeah, that way you don't burn out and you are finding ways to have appropriate self-care. And that's one of the things we talk about with the people that we work with is maintaining self-care because you're going to need it.
And that can be a part of self-care.
Yeah, oh yeah, definitely it is part of self-care. And you're going to need it because this process is not for the faint. It's not easy to stand for a reluctant spouse.
Right.
It's not easy to stand in the face of rejection. I mean, it's just not. And it wears on you. And so you got to have avenues or accesses to recharge yourself, whether it's a good book or a good meal, you know, stuff in your face one time. I mean, do what you got to do, you know.
You need to be able to release tension.
Yes.
Because if you're honest with yourself, there is tension built up, especially if you're not being intimate.
Yeah.
You know, just be real.
Yeah.
You have that tension. You're married and you want a release.
Yeah. So we're not saying go and get a release somewhere else.
No.
That's you.
Work
just,
out. Yeah, do whatever you got to do.
Stop being nasty. Stop being nasty.
Whatever you got to do to release your tension. And then I know I was talking with one of our coaching clients and I was telling them, you know, especially as women, we want to be able to give love and receive love. And so if that means you need to go around your family, you need to go and volunteer, you need to go to, you know, a foster home and be able to love on kids or the elderly or whoever.
Yeah.
You know, it actually helps you and it helps you to heal and be able to, you know, experience love.
Yeah.
And that will definitely help you to fill up in that area.
Yeah, no, that's key. That's key. Here, we got three more points, guys, and then we're going to be almost done. I know this is a lot of information. Thank you for hanging in. These last three points, I don't want you to skip out on them because they are just as important. Here's the third to last point. Okay, this is key, okay? Don't pray. Now, you just heard me say don't pray. Just listen, okay? I ain't done with it. Don't pray if your prayers are motivated by anxiety, fear, and worry. Don't pray if your prayers are motivated by anxiety, fear, and worry. In the end, it only adds more stress to the situation. So if you're finding, as you're doing your self-awareness analysis, if you're finding that your prayers are usually pray when you're anxious or fearful or worrying, then your prayers are fueled by the wrong things.
Right. They're not fueled by faith.
Yeah. You got to pray with faith.
Now, we're not saying that it's wrong to go to God and say, I'm scared and be honest.
Yeah, no, that's not what we're talking about.
We're not talking about that.
Yeah.
We're talking about you, quote unquote, warring for your spouse or, you know, interceding for your spouse from a place of fear or trying to control the situation.
Yes.
That's different.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Spiritual manipulation. That's what it looks like.
Yes.
Okay. And that's key. I'm telling you guys, don't pray if your prayers are motivated by the wrong things. Honestly. Because God ain't going to really accept them anyway, so you're just wasting time
and
oxygen.
Right, instead just take those things to God. Be honest with him about where you are. Tell him, God, I'm scared, I'm fearful, I'm anxious, help me with this.
Yeah.
You know, open yourself up to be healed of those things instead of trying to, you know, fake it.
Yeah. Here's another good one. Second to last point, and this is a huge one. Remember that God is using you to reflect his nature. So you got to make sure that you represent. You may be the only accurate picture of Christ in your spouse's life.
Yes.
And you have to make sure that you do it justice, that you do that image justice. Mm-hmm. Mandy gave me the most pristine picture of Christ that I've ever seen when she stood in the face of my rejection or me rejecting her. When she stood unconditionally, that's the best image I ever got of God. And you that may be you. So represent.
Yeah, and think
rep
about
your city.
It.
Rep your set. Okay?
And think about it. I mean, right
GLD,
now.
GLD, hold me down. No? Too early? Go ahead, baby. I'm sorry.
You know, turned up. I mean, you did turn up. But up. What I was going to say was just. I forgot what I was going to say.
I'm
now,
sorry.
But that's okay.
I was going to say GLD, hold me down.
Yeah, that's fine.
Hold me down. Okay. All right, let's go to the last point. All right, last point is this. Here is a word of advice, guys. And this is probably like the most important point. If you notice that the more you war, the more anxious you get, you may be warring the wrong way. Often, warring, spiritually speaking, spiritual warfare, is less of you fighting and interceding and more of you resting in God's presence. I'm going to say that again. Some of y'all ain't get that. Y'all was looking out the window. Listen. Often, spiritual warfare is less of you fighting and interceding and spitting and saying all kinds of stuff and more of you resting in his presence. Often, when we interfere with certain spiritual battles that we aren't supposed to fight, we become the very casualties of war that we're supposed to be fighting against. I'm telling you, this is key. If you're fighting from the wrong position, then you may become the very casualty that you're looking to fight against. So you have to fight, you have to pray, you have to war with wisdom. And a lot of times it looks like you resting in his presence. You don't have to sit there and yell and cry out. And I mean, now express yourself if you need to. But a lot of times it's merely resting in God's presence and understanding that he has angels that are fighting battles for us. We're the king's kids. We have a privileged position. The Bible says we are seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That gives us a very rare vantage point that, you know, our opposition don't have. Take advantage of it. Rest. Rest in God's lap. Let him hold you. Let him hug you. Let him brood over you. Let him sing over you. Maybe go and get in the book of Song of Solomon and just kind of stay in there for a while and do your warfare from the book of Song of Solomon. How about that? Mm-hmm. Like that one? That came off the dome. All right, so that's the last point. Baby, you got anything you want to add to that real fast before we wrap up? Because that's a lot of information.
Yeah, it's a lot of information. I think we had good dialogue, so I think we're good there.
Okay. Well, guys, the whole concept of this podcast is to help you stand for your reluctant spouse without getting lost. Okay? Take some time to rehearse this information. Go back through it. If you want to comment, if you want to ask questions, you can go to mendourmarriage.com/episode 43. That's mendourmarriage.com/episode 43. Like this, comment on this, share it with whoever you think needs to hear this. But we want to know what you think about this information. We want to know what you think. You know what I mean? Also, leave an honest rating and review on iTunes. We've been, our podcast has been climbing in the ranks, as of late. So we really appreciate the support.
Yes,
the higher it goes, cause this is not about, us. This is not a vanity metric. This is more about the higher our ratings, the more visibility this podcast has. The more visibility this podcast has, the more people who are hurting has access to this information.
Right.
And so we would definitely appreciate, you know, more ratings and reviews in iTunes. Please do that now. And then lastly, tomorrow, cause today is Thursday, this podcast is going out on Friday though. So the day that this podcast goes out, Mandy and I will be driving up to South Carolina, Lake City, South Carolina.
Yeah.
And Saturday, October 3rd, we have a speaking engagement that we're going to be speaking at. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to make sure that we get it periscoped for you guys. So check out our Mend Our Marriage page on Facebook for that information, because we'll update it there. But keep us in your prayers, and we're going to represent for y'all. You know, we got this engagement, and we're going to have some fun. So if you guys are listening to us and you live in Lake City, you know, contact us, comment on the page, let us know. We would like to take you out to dinner. We want to meet you guys.
Yes.
You know, we want to bless you guys, because you guys have been a blessing to us. So hook up with us if you're there. If not, if you like 30 minutes away, drive up and let's meet. Let's chat. Let's do lunch. Let's do breakfast. You know, we're going to be there until Sunday. Mm-hmm. So we'll try to meet up with you guys. But in any case, we appreciate your time, guys. I think we're done.
I think we are.
All right, y'all. We out, y'all.
Deuces.
Deuces.